Hope you've been having a nice day. And as Carl said yesterday, endure to the bitter end. It's my great pleasure to, I'm not introducing Dario, really everyone knows him. It was very funny when me and Dario discussed what he could talk about at this conference. He gave me this quite complex, very interesting research diagram, which was called a polygon, which was connecting all kinds of things, you know, from animal studies to cinema. And yeah, eventually decided to give this presentation, which entitled Hitchcock Presents Intertextuality, Politics and Representation. Please, Dario.
Thank you, everybody. And thank you also for coming today. I would like, first of all, to express my gratitude to the organization of this conference, which is going on beautifully, I have to say. Organization and conference are excellent, so I'm very grateful to everybody, particularly to Sorin and Lynn for arranging this. Thank you very much. So, when we are, when I was approached... Already? Okay.
Forgive me, I forgot to mention, after Dario's presentation, we'll have a screening of the movie Rope, which Dario will be talking about. That will be happening in the big hall, in the big hall downstairs, the multifunctional room, as it is called. Thank you, sorry.
Thank you. Feel free to interrupt me every second minute, that's fine. Okay, so, so again, thank you very much. When we were discussing what kind of lecture to present today, we came up, as Alin mentioned, we came up with a few ideas, and eventually we decided to do something that is a combination of a lecture with some kind of social program, really. So, after all, I'm going to talk about some contents, some semiotic analysis of possibly not the most famous of Hitchcock's movies, but one that is so filled with contents and semiotic insights that would be quite appropriate. So as Alin said, after that we are going to go downstairs and watch the actual movie. So that means also that there will be a lot of spoilers during this lecture. I hope you won't mind. So let me start by asking, who has seen this movie? Who knows this movie? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So as I said, maybe 7. So, that confirms it. This is not really the most famous, most popular of Hitchcock movies. It's, chronologically speaking, it's outside his golden peak, the one that includes the likes of The Man Who Knew Too Much, Psycho, Birds, etc. Vertigo, of course. And also, it belongs to a particular period in Hitchcock's career, the one where he tried to start this company called Transatlantic Pictures, which actually failed after just a couple of movies, really. And Rope was one of those. It wasn't a commercial success, and also for a while it wasn't a critical success either, but it was one of those main Hitchcock movies that in the long run was re-evaluated and considered nowadays one of his best. Another thing that I would like to say before starting is that this may actually sound like an old-fashioned semiotic lecture, because I'm kind of bringing semiotics to its basic endeavor, basic text, which is text analysis. And semiotics has gone in so many directions that somehow that particular aspect of the analysis has been, if not forgotten, but at least it went to a corner and it's not anymore the dominant one. So, whenever I deal with areas in art research, cinema and music being my main areas, as probably some of you know, I like very much to return to that particular basic hardcore text analysis. So this is going to be more or less like that. So, just for those who haven't seen the movie, a short introduction. So this is a movie that was released in 1948. And as it often happens with Hitchcock movies, it is actually based on an existing text. As you know, Hitchcock normally used to read literature, theater plays, even short stories, and would make up movies out of that. Somebody said it would be a little bit of a cunning choice of him to never deal with great literature. It was never the likes of, you know, John Huston trying to do Moby Dick or this kind of things. He always took very marginal stories that didn't have such a big success. What we would call nowadays big literature, in a sense. Birds was like that, Psycho was like that, and so on. This, in a sense, is one of the most qualitative type of literature that he based himself to, which is a theater play by Patrick Hamilton called Rogue, again, which was adapted from the play by Hugh Cronin, which has been a collaborator of Hitchcock in the publication. Now, the movie features James Stewart, which, as we know, is one of the most recurrent actors in Hitchcock movies, but it is worth noticing that this is the first of the long collaboration with James Stewart. And in the end, it didn't happen for two reasons. First, because initially Hitchcock wanted Cary Grant in the main role. And Cary Grant had been already appearing in Hitchcock movies, but he wasn't available for the occasion, so he asked James Stewart instead. That was the beginning of the collaboration, which brought Hitchcock into the golden period. Many of his most famous movies are with James Stewart. The other reason why it was nearly not going to happen is that there was quite some tension during the filming, and I'll tell you later why. Now, this was going to be the first color picture by Hitchcock. And this is important, not just as a technological innovation, but because back in those days, turning from black and white to color meant, among other things, to bring cinema into a more realistic idea. Now, if you think with the mind of those days, what would be the form of art that would be more realistic than cinema? It was obviously theater. So, not only Hitchcock based his movie on a theater play, but he also decided to shoot it in a theatrical manner. I will explain later why, but basically the whole movie is inside one single location in an apartment, and Hitchcock decides to fill the movie in such a way that it looks like it's continuous action, like there is no montage at all. We'll see that there is montage, but there is the illusion of no montage at all. So as I said, he was initially contacting Cary Grant for the role. Grant wasn't available, but as often happens in Hitchcock movies, there is an inside joke about Cary Grant at some point in the movie. So there is a moment in which the dinner guests are discussing cinema, movies, and actors, and somebody mentions Cary Grant. Another person that is mentioned, which was another regular collaborator, was Ingrid Bergman, the famous actress, which, according to Donald's photo, is one of the main biographers of Hitchcock. Hitchcock had a crush on Bergman. Now, why intertextuality is a key word in this movie and therefore in my presentation? Because as some of you may know, not only Rogue is based on a theater play, the theater play is based on a very famous murder that happened a few years before. So that means that the intertextual network that operates in this movie is composed of four dimensions. First of all, there is the real events. Those real events are represented in the media, and there was a lot of resonance. This murder was considered the case of the century, the first of a long series of trial of the century. You know, every time there is some like big murder, it is nicknamed the trial of the century. This was one of the first called like that. And of course, reality to media representation means already a lot of changes and a lot of interpretations, which, as we will see, are going to be pretty interesting in the way Hitchcock developed the story. Then, the theater play, which was just a few years after the event, the murder, was based Yes, on the murder, but already there was a lot taken from the media representation for the kind of conclusions and implications that the media made on that case. And then finally, many years later, we have the movie. And many years later means also that in the meanwhile, the Second World War occurred. And we'll see that Hitchcock is very aware of that because he will add changes in the story, in the dialogues that relate to that. So, of course, for Hitchcock, the main point of reference remains the play. Many of the variations introduced in the play are also variations that we see in the movie. But again, Hitchcock will add a few more things, and most of all, is very interested in constructing a different morale out of this episode. The ending is going to be quite different, and I'll show you how. So, let's start from the trial of the century. I don't know if you ever heard about this, the Leopold Loeb case. In 1924, in Chicago, two very wealthy students, college students, of the Jewish community, by the way, this is going to be important as well, and having an homosexual relation, very interesting, very passionate about Nietzsche's Übermensch theory, decide that they are superior beings, and they want to prove that by making a perfect murder, taking a person that is completely innocent, just killing for the sake of killing, and getting away by just making it very perfect, just to prove themselves as superior being. It is the kind of misinterpretation of Nietzsche that, of course, brought to even bigger tragedies in history. So they take another guy from the Jewish community, again, another wealthy guy, son of a goldsmith, called Robert Franz, so he's just 14 years old. They attract him in their car with the excuse of giving him a lift. In the car already, they knock him down with a hit. And then they take him in the outskirts of Chicago, in an area that is quite known for bird watching. And mind you, Nathan Leopold is the bird watcher himself. He will have some kind of role in the investigation. So, they bring him out there, they kill him. They drop him into a canal. Actually, apparently, they even took a sandwich, a hot dog, in a nearby kiosk, so with the corpse just a few meters away, and then they just go. The corpse is found. You see a crime scene over here. The corpse is found, and after about 1 week, the case is kind of solved. Why it is solved? Because they also find a pair of eyeglasses that were left there. These glasses belonged to Nathan Leopold. And Leopold didn't use them regularly, it was only for reading glasses, so he had them in a pocket. And while he was like dealing with the corpse, the glasses must have dropped. So at some point, actually, Leopold realized that he lost the glasses, and very possibly that he lost them there. Also because in the meanwhile they appeared in the news. He had forgotten about that, so he sees them in the newspaper, and very worried, he calls Loeb, who is more or less the leader of the two, the one who got the idea in the first place, and kind of more dominant figure. Keep that in mind as well, because this is going to be important. And I think I'm just very worried, what should we do? And reassures him, like, come on, there must be millions of those eyeglasses. It's a very common, as you can see, a very common one. They will never just arrive to us. Except that those eyeglasses had a particular mechanic in the frame, which was actually constructed by only one optician in Chicago. So they get to that shop, and it turns out that they sold this particular frames with that particular mechanic only to three people, one of which is not a Leopold. Now, initially, Leopold tried to justify that by saying that he went there bird watching. It was known to a lot of people in the neighborhood that he was a bird watcher. But after a while it doesn't hold. The police ask him to prove how the glasses may have dropped. And so after a little bit of pressure, he actually surrenders and he confesses, and of course he calls into question also look. So the two are arrested. And so initially, these are the two guys, Leopold on the left and Leopold on the right. Initially, the newspapers are bewildered. There is everything to make this murder like the most horrible, the most disgusting, outrageous type of murder ever. Because these guys killed for the sake of killing, just out of arrogance. Because they were homosexuals. And that, particularly in those days, there was a stereotype that the gays had a bigger inclination to be murderers. So there was the stereotype of the murderous gay, which was very present. After that, they are Jewish. So there is also the anti-Semitic element. After that, they killed a poor young boy, 14 years old. Luckily, it was immediately proved that there was no sexual abuse involved. But you know, the other stereotype would have been that the gays are also pedophiles. So everything seems to be quite, and they're wealthy, they're rich, so there's not even the motivation for you know, somebody who was in desperate need of money. When they make the investigation, of course the profile is built on the two of them. It turns out that they are particularly intelligent. They are very brilliant students, and actually Leopold is a child prodigy as well. As it is proved, there is a website, I hope it will open, otherwise I'll just describe it. There is a website where all the files of the murder case, would you like, yes, I do. The murder case are stored. I just would like to isolate one of the documents, which strike me as very interesting. There is a small essay that, hello? We won. Yes. How much?
1-0.
Who?
Italy.
Ede. Even Ede. Okay. Yes. Italy won over Sweden 1-0.
Thank you very much.
So this is the whole file, and at some point they actually took one. So this is the profile of Leopold, and they even find an essay that he wrote when he was a kid. Now think about that. Somebody who writes as a kid and he said called Impressions While Sick, which has already the clear structure when he say introduction with symptoms, feelings while awaiting the doctor, fear and misgiving, imagination after the doctor visit, the ailment, the period of convalescence, etc., etc. So, I mean, I even have master students who are not capable to do that, let alone. So, anyway, if you're interested, that's. So basically, every single element in this story is such that all the people want them killed. Want capital punishment. There seems to be no better example for capital punishment than something like that. Which means, from a legal point of view, that this is a perfect case for somebody who is against capital punishment to try and defend these guys. And that was Clarence Darrow. I don't know if anybody heard of him. He's a famous anti-capital punishment attorney. So he thought, if I manage to save these two perfectly evil people from the capital punishment, then you know it's much easier to make a case with those borderline situations where you know the guy may be innocent, maybe you know victim of discrimination, etc., etc. As we know, there have been many cases in history. So he decides to take the case, this almost impossible case. Does anybody know what happened? Did he save them or not, in your opinion?
One of them.
Sorry?
He saved one of them.
He saved one. Who offers more? He saved them both. He actually managed to, okay. Just let me take a step back. He saved them both. He actually managed to get a lifetime imprisonment plus 99 years, but still got the capital punishment. So it was like a major victory for anti-capital punishment movement. But at the same time, you know, the media were very, very enraged about that. Everybody still wanted them killed. These are some of the newspapers I could find of the very first week after the murder. So what happened during imprisonment? There's also some interesting story here. So Leopold Loeb, the dominant of the two, the leader of the couple, he actually got killed in prison after 7 years, I think, 1936, yeah. Allegedly because he tried to harass another of the prisoners. But you know, all suspicions go to the fact that there was a sort of revenge inside. Because as you know, inside jail there is a sort of alternative morale. Some criminals are more criminals than others. So if you have been killing a kid, that makes you more guilty than just regular murder for some other motive. So that was killed. Leopold, on the contrary, decided to do his best to sort of redeem himself. So being the very intelligent and cultivated person he was, he volunteered to teach literature to other prisoners. He was like one of those very model prisoners. And after 33 years, he got released. And you can see a picture of Leopold coming out of jail and starting a new life by actually marrying a woman a few years later. Then he would die of a heart attack, but he enjoyed 12 years of freedom anyway. So he, this lady is called Trudy, she was a florist, and they got married. And this is Leopold in his older age. So it's a quite engaging case, I'm sure you will agree. So let's see what happens later. In 1929, so 5 years after the case, Patrick Hamilton, a rather famous writer, mostly a novelist, but also known for theater plays, he writes a play called Rogue, which has very much a Grand Guignol style. I don't know if you're familiar with Grand Guignol. It was a form of theater, kind of horror theater, that was popular in the beginning of the 20th century, and then with the impact of cinema, it kind of got into a crisis. But still, in the 1920s, you could still see some shows with like fake blood, you know, undead people, vampires, all kind of gothic stories. It is important to mention why Hamilton chose to write a play inspired by the case. He had he was repeatedly abused by during school by some schoolmates in a kind of environment of male-only classrooms where they would do this kind of group masturbation and things like that. So he was bullied a bit, so this was a little bit, he became sort of homophobic out of this childhood trauma. There is some changes that he applies. Being an Englishman, he places the case in London and not in Chicago. He changes the names. They become Brandon and Granito as surnames, and we will see that Brandon will remain also in Hitchcock version, except that Brandon becomes a given name, not a surname. They don't kill a younger boy, but they kill a fellow student called Kentley. And the whole scene is moved from outdoor into an apartment. And after that, the murderers, they organize a dinner party where they invite also the father of the victim. And they hide the corpse inside the trunk. Also, the case is solved, instead by the police, is solved by the teachers or the teacher of this couple. So these are all variations that Hitchcock will take up. The other interesting thing is that Patrick Hamilton is a Marxist writer. So his standpoint is Marxist. So he's very much irritated with the wealth of the two guys, the arrogance of that. So he thinks very much of Marxist guys. And then we go to the movie, which, as I said, is mostly based on the play. It takes up most of the variations introduced by Hamilton, but it has also several adjustments. And there are important variations, particularly in the dialogues, because most of all, Hitchcock is interested in making a political point. Now, this is 1948, the World War is finished, the Shoah has happened, Nazism has happened, with all the Nietzschean implications of that. And of course, Hitchcock is a renowned conservative, so his idea comes very much from a conservative standpoint, as opposed to Hamilton's Marxist views. So this is a picture of the set, by the way. Hitchcock has some characters, and some others that are existing are changed in characterization. The couple's teacher is older than in the play, because it's not anymore just a teacher, it's a former teacher of the couple, the prep school teacher. And the other thing, we won't have time today, but if you have a chance, and YouTube is very easy to find, watch out for the trailer for that movie, because Hitchcock took particular care in doing the trailer, because he constructed the whole prequel of the movie. So everything that happens before the dinner with his guests is portrayed in the trailer. So it's a very interesting thing. Plus, Hitchcock was so confident in the power, the narrative power of the movie, that basically in the trailer everything is revealed. You see shots from the last sequences of the movie. You see who were the murderers. You see who solved the case. You just see everything. It's like the biggest spoiler of all times, that trailer. But that just proves how much Hitchcock was confident about the narrative power of the movie. Which is typical of Hitchcock, by the way. He was the guy who would refuse most of the time to put music in his movies, because he thought that it could be scary without the music. That the sequences were so scary that they didn't need music. Remember The Birds, for instance. And by the way, it's to Bernard Herrmann's credit, the famous composer, collaborator of Hitchcock, to have insisted heavily to put some music in the famous shower sequence in Psycho, because Hitchcock didn't want to put music neither there. So it really thanks to Herrmann that we have one of the most instantly recognizable horror themes of all times. And Herrmann was one of the very few people that Hitchcock would listen, otherwise he would always go his own way. So, when it comes to style, as I said, Hitchcock wanted to create very much a theatrical dimension. So not only everything is in one single location, it is also shot in a way that looks like a continuous long shot, without any interruption whatsoever. Which of course was technically impossible in those days, because you had the reels that lasted maximum 10-12 minutes, depending on how much you were stretching them. So, he made 10 real-time shots connected in a way that they look continuous. So, when does the reel changes, you will see in the movie that there are moments in which the camera goes in a very dark place. Like, let's say, the back of the jacket, it goes black, and that's the moment where the cut is. But then the next scene continues exactly where the jacket left. So, he makes these kind of illusions. There's only one part of the movie which is a clear cut, and probably you will notice that. So, the final thing is that when you have a 10-minute scene in filmic timing, it's an exceptionally long time for an actor. Imagine if somebody makes a mistake at 9 minutes and 50 seconds, you have to start all over again. Which, of course, pissed James Stewart terribly off. And he was very much on the point to leave the set, because he just thought, okay, I can't have any more of this. But anyway, they insisted, particularly when the mistake was not from the actors, but was risen from the camera, that they would make some noise while moving the camera, and they said, oh, we have to start again. So, anyway. And by the way, one of the problems was that they were using sliding walls to move from one point to another, and then sometimes they could make noise, and that was the moment when they had to stop and start again. So, as we all know, Hitchcock had a lot of topoi in his films. He would repeat motifs over and over. And this is a time in his career when he has already some topoi, but he's also developing some new ones. So here are some things that you find in the movie that are common in his movie. So the murder escape. There's at least two more movies, according to some other studies, there are actually even more. But definitely Murder, the movie Murder, where there's a transvestite being the killer, and Strangers on the Train. These are other two cases of a murderous gay situation. Then, most of the women in Hitchcock movies are very superficial, very silly, they don't understand what is going on, etc., etc. So, of course, we have quite a few characters also in this movie. We have close cases in claustrophobia, quintessentially so. The most claustrophobic movies that Hitchcock made are actually one after the other. It's Lifeboat, the one before Rogue, which is all on a boat, and this one in a park. Then he made other claustrophobic situations, but these are definitely the two biggest ones. Then, of course, there are cameos that Hitchcock puts in each of his movies, and there are two cameos, which is quite unusual, except that one is a real cameo, another one is an image of him. Then the fact that the bad guys in Hitchcock movies tend to be quite refined, and you almost sympathize with them. And I think there will be a point in the movie, especially the first half an hour, when you kind of, you know, perversely like the murderers, because they are this very refined, with very sharp sense of humor, etc. Then the fact that there's always brandy in Hitchcock movies, so there will be a point also in which brandy appears in this movie as well. There is a possessive mother, as often in Hitchcock movies, although in this particular case it's a character that doesn't appear in the movie, but it's just the mother of the victim who is very preoccupied, but she's not joining the party, but she often appears in the conversation. And then the other thing, as I said, the almost total absence of music, which was another hint to a theatrical dimension. So there's only non-diegetic music at the very beginning and at the very end, when which are the only moments where you see some outside space. Otherwise, inside, it's all only diegetic music. One of the two killers, Philip, is a pianist, so sometimes he plays music. And we will see that this has a role as well. So, as I said, the movie is located inside an apartment, except the beginning, and where we see the outside, and the end, where we hear the outside. Otherwise, it's all very, very claustrophobic. And I don't know if this will make the same effect to you as well as it did on me in one of the 35 times I saw this movie. There is a point in which really, when the window is open and you hear the noise from outside, it is almost like you feel the air coming in. Because the movie got so accumulated so much tension that you actually feel liberated. Finally, the window is open and you hear the fresh air, but it's almost like you feel it. Now, what is the point? The outside represents the American society that doesn't want these kind of things to happen. And these kind of things are both the murder like this, but also, in general, the tragedy of the war, the tragedy of Nazism, and so on. Right, the inside is this evil place. So, it's not a coincidence that the two cameos that Hitchcock chooses are both from the outside. We see, at the very beginning, by the way, right when the inscription directed by Alfred Hitchcock will appear. So this guy here is Hitchcock walking. And then during the inside part, there is a neon, a red neon light, which is outside, seen from the window, which is nothing else than a famous profile that Hitchcock had, not a famous fat profile. Which, if you want to continue with intertextuality, has an inscription under, which is reduco. Reduco means I reduce in Latin. And reduco was an advertisement that had appeared in Lifeboat, the previous movie, as an advertisement for a slimming
proverb, for a diet proverb. So that same advertisement have, of course, in this movie, in form of you know, Hitchcock, which at this point was gaining weight. So it's inside joke, but at the same time it shows the correspondence and the relation with life. So I'll try maybe to go faster here. One of the main problems that Hitchcock had, as everybody before 1968 had in the American cinema, was to deal with the motion picture production code, which was this very restrictive code for how to use certain sequences, certain themes, certain dialogues in movies. It was also known as Hays Code, because William Harrison Hays was the politician who devised it. So this was the motion picture rating system that preceded the MPAA, the one that is still going on nowadays, which is much more permissive, and which was launched in 1968. If you make up your mind a little bit about American cinema, you will notice that after 1968, in American cinema, there's a lot of more blood, a lot of more nudity, a lot of more you know, controversial, moral ambiguity. It all develops very much after 1968. All those cases before that were heavily censored. It's not that directors couldn't do that, but you know, the people in those days would see them heavily censored. So the Hays Code was very funny to read, actually. There were three basic principles. Number one, no picture should be produced that will lower the moral standards of those who see it. So there was an idea of moral standards not to be lowered. Hence, the sympathy of the audience should never be thrown to the side of crime, wrongdoing, evil, or sin. Number two, correct standards of life, subject only to the requirements of drama and entertainment, should be presented. Three, law, either natural or human, shall not be ridiculed, nor shall sympathy be created for its violation. Consequences were things like no nakedness and suggestive dances, no ridicule of religion, no depiction of illegal drug and alcohol use unless required for proper characterization, like, you know, a drunken building or something like that, no explicit crime methods and executions, no reference to sex perversion, like homosexuality, venereal disease, and no depiction of childbirth, because of course that's the most outrageous thing you can show, no offensive language, and there was a list of the swear words you could not use, no revenge in modern times, that is, if you're doing Hamlet or, you know, something based on Shakespeare, that's fine, but if you do something modern. No threats to the sanctity of marriage and home life, so if you do, if you show cheating, it has to be a bad action, not. No depiction of low forms of sexual relationship, like adultery, as common, acceptable, or nice things. No international marriage and procreation, that's why Guess Who's Coming to Dinner is a movie dated 1969. If you've seen that, you know, it's the first portrayal of international marriage as something positive in American cinema. No scenes of passion unless strictly necessary for the plot. No excessive and lustful kisses, which probably somebody had a chronometer to see how long a kiss could go on. Respectful treatment of the US flag and fair representation of the people and history of other nations. This America never got rid of. You may notice that there's not a single mainstream American movie that doesn't have the American flag appearing at some point. Even if they go abroad, at some point the people dressed by the American embassy so that this flag will be shown. 13, vulgarity, which is defined as low, disgusting, unpleasant, though not necessarily evil subjects, are subject to the dictates of good taste. So, you know, no childbirth whatsoever, but vulgarity, you know, can be if done with taste. And that the same with capital punishment, third-degree methods, so even torture can be shown in cruelty to children or animals, prostitution and surgical operations. So that's a matter of taste. But childbirth, no, please. So this is Hays, and you can see why he devised such a restrictive code, I think. Now, how does Hitchcock cope with Hays code? So the main two problems for him was the fact that there was a murder on the movie. So that was solved by making a very soft murder scene. There is just a few seconds of strangling the guy with the rope, and no blood whatsoever, shown nothing really violent. So we see him die, and that's it. And by the way, this is the moment, and an Italian scholar called Roberto Costi actually made a connection that
this sequence is a portrayal, a representation of the Pitti, La Pietà, by Giovanni Bellini. And actually, there are some good points in that. First of all, because okay, the victim is the Jesus, so the person who is sacrificed, and this is the Virgin Mary, and this is Saint John. So even though these are, you know, friends, so to speak, with Jesus, but still, one is a man and one is a woman. And in the couple, in the homosexual couple that Hitchcock represents, this is the stereotypical man, the leading, the dominant guy, and this is the stereotypical woman of the situation. So. And so we could make other connections, but I think they would be a little bit forced. So I think these two connections are the reasons why Hitchcock was representing the painting. Thank you. So, the soft murder version was fine, so no other problem there. Now, Hitchcock had to deal with homosexuality. Now, I would like to say, it's a strange time to talk about homosexuality, murderous gays with, you know, what happened in Orlando just a few days ago. So I wasn't sure how much I should, but maybe actually it is the right time to talk about stereotypical descriptions, homophobia and things. So probably, even though this is all done with humor and sarcasm and everything, but still it reflects a strong homophobic feeling from the side of Hitchcock, from the side of the people who commented on this case. So probably it is the right time. So, Hitchcock solves the problem of showing this couple as homosexuals in two main ways. The first is using a lot of dark humor, which admittedly Hitchcock was a master of. I mean, many of the most effective dark humor representations in cinema are from Hitchcock, no doubt about it. Another thing is music, exactly music, and I'll tell you why. So, what you have to pay attention is right after the guy has been killed, which is what I showed you here, everything that happens right after is a metaphor of the sexual intercourse. The moment when they kill is the orgasm that the two are having, and everything that happens afterwards is the typical after-sex situation. So, the man of the situation is lighting a cigarette. Then they start commenting, how was it? Ah, I don't know, I felt very, you know. All the post-coitus classical situation. At some point, he wants to light on the lamp, and he goes, no, let's leave it like this for a while. You know, just everything is just a naughty metaphor of the... But then there is even a point in which here, they are opening a bottle of champagne, which is a very cheap metaphor for orgasm again, and he can't manage, so he takes it, the man takes it, and continues. It's very easy, for instance, you see a lot of the posture and interpersonal distance shows very clearly that he's the woman of the case and he's the man. He looks to her, to him, sorry, and he looks, you know, forward. And there's plenty of situations like that. That was a very typical way of perceiving gays as basically surrogates of man and woman. People didn't think that two homosexuals could be a man or a woman with their own identity, blah, blah, blah. They thought that somehow they were trying to replace the classic man and woman situation. So, because in those days, the man had to be the rational guy, the intelligent one, and the woman is the irrational, emotional, passionate. This is what happens exactly. Starting from the fact that Richard Lerner, which is represented by Brandon here, who was the dominant guy, the guy who had the idea, the leader of the two. And Nathan Leopold was the more sensitive one, the one who makes the mistake, who leaves the glasses, and the weaker guy, the one who also finds redemption afterwards. You know, she becomes a good man during the jail period, and you know, teaches, and then gets married, and so on. So he does the same thing. He's the rational, intelligent one, and he's the passionate one that loses it at some point. There is even a point, which is a very typical situation in man-woman interaction back in those days, where he actually slaps the partner, which was very typical in American movies in those days. When the woman at some point goes mad, the man, puff, you know, slap the woman, so just be calm now. And that's a very typical thing. So he slaps him at some point. Now, he's a pianist, again, so the woman of the situation is also more artistic, obviously. So he's a wannabe famous pianist, and what is the piece that he plays all the time is a piece by Francis Poulenc, who was one of the very few openly gay composers in those days. One of the, I mean, there were plenty of homosexual composers in those days, but not everybody would reveal that. Poulenc was one of the few that was openly gay. So, another thing, and I'm soon concluding, another thing is that not only Hitchcock is homophobic, he's also very much misogynistic, chauvinistic person. So there are some theories that some scholars have suggested that actually he mixes homophobia with misogyny. So, as I said, there were other murderous gays in his movies. By the way, Strangers on the Train has the same Farley Granger protagonist, who was actually a gay actor. So I think it was no coincidence. Now, the fact that there is a woman surrogate, but also there are other women in the movies, which are all these very superficial, not very clever people, shows very much Hitchcock's position towards women. So all the other guests, the innocent ones, are other, if they are men, they are rational, they are cultivated, they have high moral values, like the father of the victim, and one, the teacher, solves the case, James Stewart. The women, on the contrary, the innocent ones are superficial, irrational, superstitious, there is even an aunt which is obsessed with zodiac signs and astrology, and they have no clue what is going on. There is another topos, the cool blonde, typical topos, Kim Novak, D.B. Heather, and Ingrid Bergman, etc., etc. But there is no cool blonde in this particular movie, which is possibly a clue that Hitchcock is more interested in giving a focus to the woman of the case, which is one of the two murderers. And then there was even a theory by Theodore Price that actually Hitchcock sees the women the very same way as Jack the Ripper does. They are all prostitutes. And the theory is that every woman represented in Hitchcock movies are variations of the prostitute type or stereotype. It's very courageous, very extreme theory, but there may be some truth. Otherwise, I very much suggest about Hitchcock and homophobia this article by Romney. And finally, what is the morale that Hitchcock takes from, wants to convey from this movie and in comparison with the other three texts, reality, media representation, and theater play? First of all, Hitchcock removes completely the anti-Semitism. The characters are not Jewish, there's no anti-Semitism involved at all. First, because Hitchcock was not an anti-Semitic person, and second, because the show had happened. So there was really no place for making a reference to the Leopold and Loeb case by stressing on the Jewish thing. It maintains, like Hamilton did, it maintains the wealthy social environment of the case, and this is probably not so much a political statement, but mostly referred to a Hitchcock preference for this refined bad guys. It maintains very much the connection with the Übermensch theory, except that he adds also the Nazi element, which in the meanwhile had happened. There's a whole conversation about Nietzsche in the movie. And even the murderers feel so much superior that they actually think that Hitler is an idiot, but not from the anti-fascist perspective, from the fact that he wasn't clever enough in his evil plan. So they even feel superior to Hitler's logic. So, as I said, the murderous gay is very much a topos in this movie as well. There is a continuity between Lifeboat and Rope. Lifeboat, for those who have seen it, was a movie where Hitchcock, at the beginning of the Second World War, was warning the world that the evil is inside us, and if we don't take care, if we don't pay attention, the evil can spread out of a single community, not necessarily from outside. So once at that point, Rope is the ideal sequel, where he also states that yes, but there is also some major evil that that may come, in this case, from Germany, from Nazi Germany. And finally, and sorry for the spoiler, the most important point is that Hitchcock wants to change history. He doesn't like the idea that Leopold and Lerck got away with just lifetime imprisonment. He makes it very clear that the guys have to be killed, because his conservative standpoint is that murderers like that have to be killed. And that's the final statement, with James Stewart saying, "You're gonna die!" And that's a conclusion for the book. So, thank you very much.
How much would the actors have known about this analysis that you just give? Would Hitchcock say to them, "This is not murder, it's sex, and you're the man, you're the woman, you've got to stand in this posture"? I'm just wondering how much you contrived this.
I don't know how much was within them. As a tradition, Hitchcock wasn't telling too much to the actors. There were even points in which he would surprise the actors with things that they did not expect, like some assault, particularly if it was a woman character. The actress was not informed that the next moment there would be somebody assaulting her, so that the surprise was real, and so on. So just taking this as a general rule, I would imagine that they were not fully aware of the whole thing. However, both Granger and Dahl, the two main actors, were actually gay. So I'm sure, I'm fairly confident that Hitchcock must have talked to them. We want to represent a gay couple, but we cannot do it openly. So, let's do this and this and so on. And Hitchcock was not new to these noted metaphors. You may remember North by Northwest, there is a moment in which the man and the woman are in the train, they are having sex, and instead of showing the sex sequence, they show the train entering the gallery. So it's a cheap metaphor again. There were several of these things. So I don't know for sure. The spot on chess, possibly the most comprehensive biography of Hitchcock, doesn't mention specifically there was any talk. So I cannot really say. Thank you.
Thanks for questions.
How much do you think it was relevant that the crime was, let's say, relatively recent, and maybe for the Americans, the crime happened to take place 20 years before, they will recognize the story, consequently they will recognize all the deviations from the initial story and the ideology thus purported with the movie?
Right, that's actually a very good question, because as it happens, both Hitchcock and Hamilton officially denied that there was a direct connection with the Leopold and Lerck case. They admitted that there were several things in common, but Hamilton, in his play, he said, no, I was not inspired by that. Yes, of course, it looks a little bit like that, but I wasn't thinking about that. Then, of course, later on, analysis of that showed that there were too many references for being just a coincidence. And Hitchcock, in turn, always said that, well, I based this movie from this play. But obviously the connection is very strong. I think it was still a traumatic case, because at the time when the movie came out, Lerck had been killed and Leopold was still in jail, and there was still this perception 20 years later that there was a great injustice not killing these people. So the public opinion were happy that Leopold had been killed in jail, and they were unhappy that Leopold was still getting away with it. Thank you.
More questions? No long-winded, self-indulgent, relating to nothing, no? Disappointing? Well, in this case, we might move on with the movie then.
Okay.
On
to the movie. So we did like 5 minutes of break while I set up the movie downstairs?
Yeah.
Okay, so the movie will be done. It's a very short movie, it's less than 1 hour and a half, so we won't be too long.